Can I have your attention? Thank you, thank you. We're going to open up the zoning meeting. My name is Stephanie Phillips. I am the zoning chairperson. I asked a couple of things, just so we have a number of people here, which is wonderful. That is one of the things. I asked for your indulgence to try to keep the room as quiet as possible so that we can hear the applicants, which is the reason why we have this hearing. We will have a portion of it where during the public hearing, after the applicants have made their presentations, that the public will have a chance to come up and speak and add their comments for or against. So just bear with me. Cell phones, if you can turn those off, that would be good as well, or put them on vibrate. I appreciate that. The formal part of this meeting is that I need to read to you. The Zoning Commission is now open for public hearing for those petitions advertised and heard in this session. For the record, the petitions to be heard this evening were advertised in the Connecticut Post on 10/12/2016 and 10/19/2016. These properties were duly posted on 10/18. So, for the record, thank you. We have a number of applications this evening. We have a very full agenda. Given that we have so many people here, I thought I'd just take a quick moment to let you know what the agenda looks like so you know where your application that you're interested falls in. The first three, 443 King Street, 1166 Barnum Avenue, and the third one, 1166 Barnum Avenue, are really basic. The three applications, but one property that we'll take together, followed by 700 Lordship Boulevard. Then there's the fifth one, fourth one, is a Point Stratford renewal text amendment. The one that followed, one of the big ones, 382 Ferry Boulevard, has been postponed to the November agenda. So if you're here for 382 Ferry Boulevard, we won't be hearing that tonight. That's followed by another text amendment for the Coolidge properties, which is also part of 225 Lordship Boulevard. Those two go together. Nearing the end of our agenda, I'm sorry, is 1307 Stratford Avenue and 40 Johnson Court. So you're a little bit near the end of the agenda. That's why I asked you to have some patience. The last item that we have on the agenda for a public hearing is 2505 Main Street, which is the Lazy Dog Management. Knowing where your properties are, please extend as much courtesy to all the other properties so we can get through this agenda. I promise I will try to move this process along as efficiently as I can and keep it as open and friendly as possible. All right. The first properties that I'd like to have to discuss is 443 King Street, 1166 Barnum Avenue, and 443, 445 King Street, which is often known as the Merle Anderson Company Incorporated Progress. Mr. Rizzo.
The commission, if you, we had sent a letter in requesting this matter to be continued to the end of November agenda, as we've been trying to meet with the traffic authority to coordinate the changes that they're going to be recommending, which will be implemented by the state and the corner, to see if there's anything that we can do to adapt our site plan to make it consistent with and hopefully acceptable to the commission and the traffic authority by coordinating the improvements that are going to be made by the state with the traffic authority. They have still not been able to do that, and they were trying to get the squared away with them next month. I will tell you that if we can't get it squared away next month, we'll withdraw the application. But we'd like just one more opportunity to try and meet with the traffic authority and see if there's anything we can salvage with them that'll make them comfortable with the traffic flow in the traffic plan for our property. And that's kind of where we are.
This is the traffic authority of Stratford, or the DOT?
Stratford. And we've also been dealing with the state and then trying to get a consensus as to the improvements that are going to happen on that corner, which will allow us to either make a modification or withdraw our application if there's nothing that's been agreed to in the foreseeable future.
One of the key things that you were going to, that we did extend it to this month, was to allow you to work with the Starbucks Corporation to find out if they would accept a right only as a stipulation off of Nichols Avenue. Have you gotten any response?
We've talked to them, and they wanted us to get, before we committed one way or the other on that, to just understand what was going on with the state improvements, because then they didn't want to find themselves in a position where they were locked in with a project that has approvals, but approvals that they couldn't live with. They may, depending on what the state does, be able to modify the application to make it work.
So
basically, if nothing were to change, and this commission said, and the state was not going to do anything, and there were not going to be improvements that the traffic authority would accept, and the condition of approval was a write out only on the Nichols Avenue, it'd probably be very difficult for them to make the project go forward. Given the ability, given they wanted us to just please to find out because they spent a considerable amount of time and money on this project, before they, you know, rendered a final decision on that, they really wanted to get more clarification from the state as to actually what will happen in that corner to see if they can live with it. And that's where we are.
Mr. Fuller?
Just curious. First, I want to extend a thank you for exploring these questions, and thank your client for exploring those questions.
I appreciate you making it perfectly clear what your concerns were.
And I appreciate you doing the homework and going the extra mile to answer the commission questions. Just a question on the traffic authority, the local traffic authority, not state per se, because I know that's another tier of bureaucracy.
Right.
Did they provide any information, or they just haven't been able
to? My client and the traffic engineer have been handling it. I've been involved in those specific discussions.
But that's pretty much it. I'm just trying to figure out just what the holdup is locally, at least. We can't control the state. That's a whole other tier of bureaucracy. But just seeing if there's any way we could expedite the traffic authority.
That's
the only reason, I mean, one of the things, if there are modifications, I could always withdraw and submit or get denied without prejudice. I'm just saying we're this far all along, all the presentations, and we're just asking the commission to just grant us one additional meeting. And if we can't have that resolved by the next meeting, we'll withdraw it.
Well, if I'm understanding this correctly, you're really predicating this on what you could possibly do with the state. It's all predicated around if the state moves forward with some of the changes that you mentioned that we haven't seen yet. Is that correct?
Correct.
And you're asking us if we could wait a month to see if the state would comply with some of those changes or at least release that. What's the likelihood of that?
I don't know. Who's going to win on Tuesday? Well, that's pretty clear. That would actually be a much easier question to answer. I apologize. I don't know.
Okay. For my commissioners, you have a couple of choices, and the attorney did summarize it pretty well. We could grant them the continuance to the next month if you so choose, or we could deny without prejudice, which means that they can reapply at any point in the future and nothing is held against them. Probably the downside for the applicant, and tell me if I'm wrong, is that they would be paying the fees again to reapply, but they would not be limited in terms of whatever application that they put forward.
And then you'd also have to hear me drone on and on and on and establish a record. So you probably heard me once is enough. And
you're a nice guy. We like you.
Well, you get me later tonight, so that's I think more once a night is probably more than enough.
Mr. Fuller?
I think it's fair to grant them, considering that they're trying to seek information from a bureaucratic entity, whether local traffic authority, state DOT, and state traffic authority. I think it's just fair because we asked them to provide this information, and here's a good faith effort for them to try to make that answer that question. And the reason why I don't have it, it's not really because of their doing.
Thought, Mr. Fuller. Mr. Fuller,
No, if you need a motion or a second, I would do that. But being that we were talking about likelihoods prior, just before, did anybody ever think of just staying where you are and adapting onto that piece of property where you're at instead of trying to go next door?
You know, the big issue, as you know, with any service-oriented business in today's world, we're driven by the drive-throughs. And I don't think not the ability to put a drive-through on that site in their location.
Think you could get an architect that would come because you're on the outside of a building there? And
the problem becomes circulation. You need to get if you see most drive-throughs, they all need circulation around a building to be able to order and pick up. And to try and get it, they almost never work on a shopping center unless it's an end cap. And then if they're too big, you can't circle the whole.
Well, that's what I was saying. It is on the end and everything, and there's like a half a dozen roads in there. But no, that's fine. I appreciate your
That's really...
And what you're doing, and...
That's where we are, yeah.
Ms. Baker, any thoughts? Okay. Mr. Forrester, any thought?
I'm fine with the extension.
It's your lucky day, actually. I was actually more moved to, I'll be honest with you, to deny without prejudice, because I don't have the faith in the state. Not that you haven't done a lot of work. It's just that I don't have the faith in the state.
Chairman,
but
I appreciate the commission extending us this one time, because there has been a ton of time and money spent to get to this point.
I know we haven't taken a motion, but given I'm very willing to listen to the commission, and other than the fact that it just extends it on another month, is there a motion that one of the commissioners would like to make?
So moved. I'd like to make a motion to recess or continue this triplicate application of 433 King Street and 1166 Barnum Avenue to the November public hearing.
It's been motioned. Second?
I'll second that.
Second by Mr. Giuliano. All in favor?
Aye.
Chair votes aye.
I'll commit, if we don't have it cleared up, I'll have this withdrawn prior to the next meeting so we don't have to go through the explanation. And I'll save you the time. So I thank you for the time.
Thank you. Motion's been passed. No one's opposed. Thank you. All right, the next item that we have on our agenda is 700 Lordship Boulevard for the All Ford Service Repair.
Good evening, Chairperson and Commissioners. My name is Christina Porter. I'm from Carroll, Kersaden, and Moore. With me is David Young. He is the applicant, All Ford Service Repair, LLC.
I'm going to ask you just to hold 1 second. I jumped a little quickly forward. Mr. Fuller?
Yes.
Why don't you start? Could you read into the record the
Sure thing, Madam Chair.
Application.
We have plenty here. I think everyone's going to get a crack at one of them. The petition of 700 Lordship Boulevard, All Ford Service Repair, LLC, approval of a location in a general repairs license per section 10.2.1 in an MA district.
Thank you. Proceed.
Thank you. So this petition is an approval for location for a general repairs license. The land use is permitted as a per right under sections 7.1.4 and 10.2.1. The property previously did have a general repairs license business at the property. It used to be a Harley mechanic dealership. In the intervening years, it was an HVAC distributor. My client, All Ford Service Repair, is a state licensed general repairer at this time. His current shop is in Milford, but he needs to expand and would like to come here to Stratford. There's no proposed changes to the site, the structure of the site. There will be some minor interior changes, which we've provided for you in the floor plans. And at this time, we would just request that you approve this application so he can move on to get his state license transferred over to this location.
Thank you very much. I'll open up to questions from the commissioners. Mr. Fuller.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have two very quick questions. First is the general hours of operations.
8 to 5.
8 to 5, 7 days a week?
Monday through Saturday.
Okay, so, and you're closed on Sunday?
Yes, sir.
Oh, thank you for that. And to my knowledge, if I read zoning staff comments and your testimony, that this was a general repairs license before?
Yes.
Okay, so you're not really fundamentally changing the use. I do have a follow-up question. What sort of aesthetics on the outside, what sort of landscaping and external exteriors would you do to pretty much make this a very pleasant to the eye, present to the sight sort of look? That's one thing we're always kind of cognizant about as a land use board.
Yes, sir. There's some existing shrubs there. I mean, if you rode by there recently, you probably couldn't see them because the grass is so high. But we're thinking about doing something maybe with some awnings and stuff like that, you know. I mean, I don't know exactly what we have to do with the signage. And we're looking to do something with the windows, just the front fascia of the building. I know it hasn't been, in the future.
Thank you, Madam Chair. That satisfies my questions.
Mr. Giuliano?
I'm okay with just with the stipulations that are already in here, and like he just said, that he's going to take care of that little bit of property in the front of it, and the awnings, that'd be a great thing to make that place
look better
because it's been there forever.
Ms. Baker? Good. Mr. Forrester? I don't have any additional questions myself. I had the same issue of if you make the landscaping nicer, that would upgrade the building. You know, I think that's appropriate, and that was would be a stipulation as part of your approval. So may I have a motion to approve with the stipulation that the applicant has agreed to improving the low-lying landscaping treatment? Oh, that's right.
Well, it'll be a motion to close.
Motion to close. I did jump ahead.
Well, I do have one slight question, may I, before we do that?
Go ahead.
That, and you're going to do, you have all the certifications for the oil removal and everything's going to be taken up inside?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's it.
The next step is the motion to close, and we'll discuss it in an administrative session following the public hearing, and then we would make a motion to approve or deny, okay?
Public comment.
Public comment. I am really messing it up today. I know, it's a long day. Is there anyone in the who would like to speak in favor? Is there anybody who would like to speak in oppose? Thank you very much. Now I'd like to have a motion to table. I'll get back into the game
motion
here.
Motion to close.
Motion to close by Mr. Forrester, second by Ms. Baker. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone oppose? Motion closes. Tate's tabled. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Everybody's been good as I indulge trying to move this along. Okay, the next item on the agenda. Mr. Giuliano, would you like to read? It is the Point Stratford Renewal Text Amendment.
Sure. Text Amendment Petition of Coolidge Properties, LLC, seeking to add...
Number five.
I'm on the wrong one.
Point Stratford Renewal.
Okay, Text Amendment Petition of Point Stratford Renewal, LLC, seeking to add a new 8.5 to the zoning regulations and establish a waterfront development district.
Thank you very much. And the applicant? Please, your name and...
Good evening. My name is Donald Gershman. I'm a principal in Point Stratford Renewal, LLC. The applicant with me here tonight is my partner, Mike Ryan. We are here to speak in favor of the proposed waterfront development district regulation. I appreciate your consideration. This is the final step in a process that began almost 3 years ago when then-zoning official Gary Lorentzen sent me the first draft of the document that we're considering tonight. It's useful to consider the points made by Mr. Lorentzen in the email accompanying that draft. He said that his main concern was establishing a structure and a process that is workable. The regulation was created as an overlay district, which is a technique that we have used recently for the transit-oriented development district that was discussed earlier. And the main provisions of the regulations, he said, were a general purpose section, a provision discussing the process of the overlay district, creating flexibility in the number of buildings on any one lot. He pointed out that the current definition of a lot is to have only one principal building, and that this limitation, in his words, obviously needs to go away. It deals with permitted uses, and he says we will need to go over all the uses contemplated to make sure they will be covered here, as well as prohibited uses, wanting to make sure that uses the town would not want are prohibited. A section on the application process. His words, I structured this generally the same way we did for Stratford Development East and West Campus off of Lordship Boulevard. A comprehensive master plan is submitted for approval by the commission. After that, each individual building or use would be generally subject to administrative approval of the commission and not require a new public hearing as long as it is generally consistent with the master plan. There would be development and use standards. He says no specific building coverage, setbacks, building height, open space, parking, or density standards would be spelled out because all of this is to be left to the discretion of this commission. The regulations have been through many redrafts, both with Mr. Lorentzen and more recently with Mr. Hibansky. They reflect input from the mayor's office, from economic development, and in June of this year, from the then chairs of the planning and zoning commissions. But the overall structure remains the same. In preparing these regulations, attention was paid to the town's plan of conservation and development, which specifically addresses the Stratford Army Engine Plant in several locations. It states in part that it is a goal of the town to, quote, foster the redevelopment of the Stratford Army Engine Plant as a major mixed-use waterfront development that provides jobs, waterfront access, and a strengthened tax base. That, quote, the town will work with the private developer and the federal government to facilitate the remediation and redevelopment of the Stratford Army Engine Plant. That the town should, quote, exempt the Stratford Army Engine Plant property from current zoning regulations, provided that site plans are approved and state environmental review is undertaken. That, quote, this development is envisioned as a major mixed-use center for living, employment, and recreation. Fronting the river will be a continuation of the Housatonic Greenway, a multi-use roadway and public access along the length of the shoreline. And finally, quote, that vertical growth will be encouraged over single-story, large floor plate buildings with long blank walls. Large parking surfaces should be replaced by parking structures located along the first two floors of structures. We believe that the proposed zoning regulations strongly support these goals. The proposed regulations also emphasize the importance of water-dependent and related uses while promoting a wide diversity of uses, as well as seasonal, informal, and holiday programming to attract visitors. In addition, they incorporate the new site elevation standards from the town's coastal resilience plan. In general, the proposed regulations require that the project developer submit a master plan for approval by this commission. The extensive requirements for the master plan are set forth in the regulations, but generally require that the intended development be described in three dimensions and that detailed information be provided regarding traffic, parking, utilities, landscaping, public spaces, and of course uses. Once approved by this commission, the master plan, called the General Development Master Plan, or GDMP, constitutes the zoning framework for the site. As each parcel within the site is to be developed, a specific site plan is prepared and submitted for approval by this commission. That process assures that both the site improvements and the use are consistent with the master plan. In the event of proposed changes to either the master plan or to an individual site plan, a process for review and approval is set forth in the regulations, which specifically provides that any changes that are not minor be brought back to this commission for consideration. This approach will facilitate redevelopment as it will provide certainty to prospective tenants and purchasers up front that their proposed uses and locations are permitted under the master plan. I cannot overemphasize the importance of this. In today's competitive economy, having a regulatory structure that will expedite entitlements is critical. As you know, at its meeting last week, the Planning Commission voted unanimously to make a favorable recommendation to this commission for the adoption of these proposed regulations. They did, however, include four caveats that I would like to address briefly. Regarding the provision that states that an approval in the master plan of a premises for the sale of liquor will be deemed an approval under Section 15 of the zoning regs, the Planning Commission expressed concern that all of the requirements and considerations enumerated in Section 15 be addressed if approval is to be granted as part of the GDMP approval process. We agree. Our intention was never to avoid the requirements of Section 15, but rather to allow for a single application process for the site plan and the liquor approval in order to expedite the approval process. We have submitted to Mr. Hibansky for your consideration substitute language that requires full compliance with the requirements of Section 15, but still allows for a single application and hearing. I'd like to pass this around. Their second comment was that in the provision of the regulations that requires not less than 10% of the total area of the project to be devoted to recreational and other green space areas, the Planning Commission noted that it's possible that the entire 10% requirement could be satisfied by the construction of the greenway along the Housatonic River, and expressed concern that there might not be sufficient recreational or other green space areas throughout the project. We emphasize that the 10% green space and recreational space requirement is a minimum. We intend our development to be an amenity-rich project with many and varied public spaces throughout. Since the Zoning Commission has approval authority over the entire site plan, we encourage the Commission not to change this minimum requirement, but rather to let the design process go forward and then to evaluate the project as a whole. The third comment from the Planning Commission had to do with the potential height of improvements. The regulations state that no buildings may exceed 8 stories or 90 feet in height. And the Planning Commission recommends that this commission carefully consider the impact of buildings of that height with respect to massing along Main Street and with regard to views of the riverfront. Going back to the initial draft of these regulations and the comments by Mr. Lorentzen that I read to you, there was never an intention to restrict building heights on the theory that this commission will evaluate the project as a whole. It could be that you determine that taller buildings are beneficial because they allow for more green space or because they allow for parking to be placed under buildings. We inserted the 8-story, 90-foot provision in order to make a statement to you and to the community that we had no intention of proposing 20-story buildings. We have no master plan at this time. We have no plans for any buildings of any particular heights. We encourage the commission to retain flexibility that is suggested in the regulations for building design. If the commission is more comfortable striking the provision in its entirety and simply being silent about building heights, that's fine too. Because our view is we will prepare a master plan and present it to you, and you vote it up or you vote it down, as is your prerogative. The final comment from the Planning Commission had to do with something that's really beyond the scope of these regulations. They raised a concern that the Connecticut Air and Space Center, which currently rents space from the U.S. Army on the property, continue to be accommodated on the site or somewhere else so that they don't go out of business. It is outside of the scope of these regulations, but we agree with the comment. We are proud to recognize the aviation and military heritage of this site in our development. And as I advised the Planning Commission last week, it's a provision of our purchase contract with the U.S. Army that we accommodate the CASC at a location on the property. So there is no open issue there. Today, the Stratford Army Engine Plant site consists of 77 acres of land and over 1.5 million square feet of unoccupied industrial buildings. The site is significantly contaminated and is a regulated brownfield. And as you know well, as a government property, it pays no property taxes. Our redevelopment vision calls for the demolition of existing improvements, the remediation of the site, and the development of a transformative mixed-use development that will incorporate a variety of new uses, such as multiple housing options to rent or to buy, retail shops and restaurants, professional offices, an indoor sports complex, a hotel, indoor and outdoor entertainment venues, an extension of the river walk along the entire frontage of our property, and as mentioned, a new facility for the Connecticut Air and Space Museum. In light of the discussion earlier, we may propose a multimodal transportation hub. In short, we envision the now vacant Stratford Army Engine Plant transformed into an exciting mixed-use community, Stratford's premier living, shopping, dining, and entertainment neighborhood. Point Stratford will celebrate Stratford's historic relationship with the Housatonic River and Long Island Sound. It will provide public access to the magnificent waterfront for the first time in almost a century. It will honor the site's historic contributions to the development of the helicopter, the seaplane, and other significant military equipment. It will be the destination location in the town of Stratford. We believe that the adoption of these regulations is essential to facilitate the redevelopment of the Stratford Army Engine Plant. And on behalf of the entire Point Stratford Renewal Team, we respectfully request that you adopt these regulations. Thank you for the opportunity to address you. I'd be pleased to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Gershon. Thank you very much. I'll open it up to questions from the commissioners. Mr. Fuller?
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you for addressing the Zoning Commission and the Planning Commission before. When I was the chairman, I'd met with both yourself, Administrator Hibansky, and Planning Chairman Chris Shahavy, to kind of go over what we thought would be traps that you could invoke the right to meet with up to two planning or zoning commissioners to kind of head off any problems before they become problems in the petition or problems in text amendment. And one thing that really came up, in addition to a focus on having some recreation and open space, the diversity of use, that you have some residential, some commercial, some retail, some office, some waterfront property, and the inclusion of the Air and Space Museum and an ode to not just Stratford's Connecticut aviation history, but Connecticut and American aviation history, which is one of the more historic elements of our town. One thing that was always very important to me was the whole process of who reviews it, what is the parameter review, what are the criteria of review. So could you just briefly go over for public consumption the three-tiered process that exists, that there is the text amendment review, which is this hearing tonight, there's a grand master plan review, and then there's the third part, which is the specific site plan review.
That's correct. The purpose of these regulations is to create an overlay district that creates essentially a blank slate for the property. It says these 77 acres can be developed for a very broad range of uses without any stated limits on the normal kinds of things that are regulated under zoning regulations. The trade-off is, in exchange for us getting that kind of latitude as the developer, you get tremendous latitude to simply say yay or nay. So what ensues, as I see it, is a conversation before this ever becomes a hearing, where we're going to be working through the master planning process. I expect we would seek to meet informally with this commission, with other people in this building, to make sure that we achieve a consensus on what will be good, not only for us as the developer of the project, but for the community. This is a big site. This is a visible site. This is the largest development to happen in this town in a long time. And we want to get it right, and we want you to be comfortable that we're getting it right. So yes, the process is the three steps you mentioned: the approval of the regulations, the adoption of the master development plan, and then site plan approval for each parcel as it comes up for development.
And specifically, that's where I would like you to just elaborate further the difference between the master plan review versus the individual site plan review, and what sort of public transparency steps are in place during that whole scenario. If we move past the text amendment, the next two steps.
The approval of the master plan is a public hearing. It's a special case. We would present all kinds of pretty pictures, which will show what we intend to build, where we intend to build it, three-dimensionally, how it would lay out, the relationship of the site to the water, the public access components, and so forth. And we would attach uses to each parcel or each building within the property. Once we've agreed on that, which is to say you've blessed it, we then go forward to sell or rent these properties to users. And as they come in, as, for example, the hotel development team comes in and says, we want to put a hotel on the piece designated for a hotel, they need to come in for site plan approval and explain the details of the building they're proposing to build, and how they're satisfying all the normal requirements that would pertain to a site plan approval.
And just could go over the logic of, I understand what the logic is, but for public record purpose, the logic of going with kind of like a piece-by-piece approach from an economic, from a feasible construction standpoint, from anything that goes into saying just overall development of the whole property versus doing it, as you suggest, a master plan with specific site plans that follow.
You're asking why we're trying to have the entire site under a single master plan, is that correct?
Oh, no. What I'm asking is the logic behind developing specific parcels at any given time.
As opposed to building it all at once?
Yes, exactly.
We don't know what's going to be there at this point. This is going to be a market-driven project. If once the zoning plan is set, the master plan is set, we then have the ability to go market the property in a way that we can't today. The people we talked with, the apartment developers, the hotel developers, and others, they want to know what they can build of right. Today it's zoned light industrial, I think. So they can't do what they want to do. I can't tell you, it doesn't make sense to create artificial sub-parcels within this and say this is in this zone for multifamily and this is in this zone for commercial, whatever. The logic is to view this thing as a totality. The reason it's not being developed all at once is it's going to be developed by multiple parties. We believe that will actually result in a faster build-out than having a single party responsible to build the whole thing, because it brings many teams with many sources of capital in at the same time.
And my final question is, could you just elaborate on the Point Stratford is a team of various entities and parties, just a little bit about the background of how Point Stratford came to be?
Yeah, Point Stratford Renewal LLC has four principals. Myself, I'm a commercial real estate and finance attorney by background. I've been involved in brownfield redevelopment and other kinds of development for a number of years. My partner, Mike Ryan, background is basically in the finance world. Ted Lane, another partner, comes from the world of real estate brokerage and was involved in the early stages of the development of the Stamford Harbor project, which in many ways is similar to this. And Jeff Larrero, my fourth partner, is the principal of Larrero Engineering Associates, which is one of the foremost experts in the state in the mechanics of brownfield redevelopment and remediation, as well as other aspects of civil engineering and surveying. We came together because we thought we brought the necessary skill sets to handle all the aspects of getting this up and running. We went through a competitive process, as you know, with the U.S. Army, where we went down to Washington and met with officials of the Army and presented our approach not only to the redevelopment but to the remediation of the property, which they found persuasive, and we entered into a contract with them to purchase the property several years ago at this point.
I'm sorry, it wasn't my final question, as a couple came up, which tends to happen, as you think. My couple other questions as well is, I take a lot of value in the four stipulations that the Planning Commission has recommended, and I'm encouraged to hear you to incorporate a lot of those in your plan. I find that it's very good to have a second board, be an extra pair of eyes, think about it from a different perspective. As you could tell, we get very busy and crowded agendas from time to time. My other question is, do you have any sense on, it seems like the holdup is between Army and DEP. Is there anything new about that, or is it still kind of going a tug of war back and forth?
For the benefit of those without the background in this, the deal we have with the U.S. Army is that we will acquire, remediate, and redevelop the land, the 77 acres, which is the Stratford Army Engine Plant. It's heavily contaminated, and we're taking that on. Adjacent to the property are the tidal flats, which are part of the Housatonic River. Those are also heavily contaminated, and by contract, the Army is retaining responsibility to remediate those. Our trigger to go forward with the redevelopment is tied to a handshake, if you will, between the U.S. Army and the State of Connecticut Department of Energy and Environmental Protection on a program to remediate those tidal flats, which the Army is obligated to do. And they've been going back and forth, negotiating for several years now on sampling that's been done, on interpretation of the sampling, on the right standards that should be applied to evaluate those standards, precedents that might pertain to decision by the DEEP, precedents that might pertain to a decision made by the Army. It's complicated. It's difficult when you have two large bureaucracies locking horns. That said, there's a lot of will both from the leadership of this community and from the highest office in the state and from members of Congress and from the U.S. senators. This site is very visible. Everybody wants it to get done, and there is increasing pressure on the Army and the DEEP to reach a conclusion. Quite frankly, one of the reasons we're pushing to get these regulations adopted now, and I understand they'll be adopted next month, hopefully, is we need to evidence progress. We need to evidence that they're holding it up, you know, and not have them be able to say, each of them, well, you know, your zoning isn't done anyway, we're not holding you up. So we're trying to get the zoning done, we're trying to get some other things buttoned up before the end of the year that will make the case stronger, that they need to come together and reach agreement so we can move forward with the development of the land.
And my
Fuller?
Yes.
Mr. Fuller?
Yes.
Do you think you might leave some questions for anybody else?
Well, it's a big project. It's a big project. So it's going to be a lot of questions.
Would you allow us to at least let me check with the other commissioners and we'll come back to you?
One more question. So what we're looking at tonight is not a master plan. It's the regulatory overview.
I'm sorry, couldn't hear.
What we're looking at tonight is not a specific master plan or development. It's the regulatory structure.
Exactly. There is no master plan for us to present to you.
No. Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, Ms. Giuliani, if you think you can think of anything.
To go with this all, thank you. Can't be more delighted that we're moving forward here. I really appreciate you and your partner and everything that you're doing. Just touch base a little bit. You said on your marketing on this amendments here, and I noticed you said it says manufacturing. That would be like unbelievable if we had some manufacturing in there. That's like one of my biggest things other than hotels and everything else. Have you seen anything coming around there yet? Even though you didn't do your master plan, I mean, you must have some issues out there that somebody has said something.
It's we have had expressions of interest periodically for from companies that would occupy flex space or light industrial space or right. warehouse space. And again, we're open to that. The property, as you know, has three land masses.
Mm-hmm.
The main 55-acre piece that's on the river, a 20-acre piece that's just south of Sniffin's Lane,
right,
and then a 2 or 3 acre piece that's sort of part of the airport parcel across Main Street.
Across from Main Street. Right.
And, you know, the 55-acre piece, I think, is clearly intended to be this sort of sophisticated mixed use that I'm describing. But the other parcels could be used for more of a flex or light industrial use, no question.
And that's the total. Is 77 acres there
yeah.
then?
Yeah, it was about 80 acres, but there was a little corner that was transferred by the Army to, I think, the FAA in connection with the relocation of
Main
Street.
And you figured it
Main
was
Street.
Like a million and a half what? It was.
It's about a million and a half square feet of empty eight, buildings right? on the property right now.
Right. And that's still in an MA district, right? I think we're still in an MA?
Light. I think it's a light industrial district, right? Yeah.
Correct. MA.
Okay. No, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Spaker?
Once you submit the master plan, you'll work with this board and the Planning Commission if there's any changes that this board doesn't feel fit the actual overall plan that you propose?
Well, I think that actually happens before the plan's adopted, right?
Okay.
We're going to submit a proposal that has a lot of boxes and pretty colors and sketches and notations on them that says, this is going to be the hotel and this is going to be the waterfront, you know, access and so on. And we'll have a very full vetting of that process with this commission, with other commissions. I envision us having informal meetings with the public outside of the strict regulatory process to answer people's questions and get input. On other projects, I've found that kind of input to be very valuable. Members of the public see things that we don't see.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you
oh,
move
absolutely.
This, we can do that. Or have you thought of adding? It's very valuable, and I'm sure we will be doing that. So once the project is fully vetted, we'll be presenting a plan. Hopefully, that you will be familiar with, comfortable with, have had your concerns addressed in advance, and be happy to endorse. Any changes that come about later, because the hotel footprint that we designated isn't where the hotel company wants to go, they want to go where the apartment building was going to go, that kind of a thing, we come back to you, we explain it, and you say yay or nay. The discretion is always with you.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Forrester? I just have one question to pick up on something you'd said earlier. Picking off from where the Planning Commission made their recommendations, the number 3 point that the Planning Commission talked about was about the height of the buildings that were suggested. Specifically, the way they read it was, it states that no building may exceed 8 stories or 90 feet in height. In your discussion, your opening statement, you had alluded to or mentioned that one of the options, and I happen to agree, is that that should not actually be included in it, that I'd like to see stricken from the language. Not that I particularly agree it's 8 stories or 6 stories or whatever that number would be, but it would give us enough latitude to take a look at what that master plan is at that time and have a better sense of what the height might look like. I think it would be premature to try to put restrictions against that building without actually seeing the full concept that could impact anyone's perception of it. Would you be agreeable to that?
Yes, absolutely. The language, even as it's retained, were it to be retained, still vests all the discretion in the commission. So removing it even makes it clearer that the commission's retaining full discretion on height and every other aspect of this development. So yes, we would agree.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Going forward, just to inform the commission, the waterfront harbor management had not had a chance to review this plan or this text amendment. They didn't meet, and they've requested that we not close the public hearing to allow them to review it and provide their comments next month. So unless there's any major objections, and I'm going to ask for some help from our attorney to get a proper motion to maintain the public hearing as open.
You would just not close the public hearing.
I don't want to close the public hearing. Now, I do have one question. The public is here. I would like to hear comments from the public before we close it. Can I move forward on that now at this point?
Yeah, you may entertain public comments. You're not closing the hearing.
We're not closing the hearing.
So you may entertain public comments. And then, you know, you can advise the public. They'll have another opportunity to speak if you,
exactly.
You know, if there are further administrative or applicant comments.
Okay, and that's exactly what I would like to do. I'm just going to repeat what Mr. Our town attorney, Mr. Clare, had said. We're not going to close public hearing, so that there will be another public hearing once we get comments back from the Harborfront Water Management Commission. I would like to open it up, though, for anyone who would like to come forward in support of this application. Anybody would like to speak? Please come forward.
Joe Paul from 47 Harborview Place. Just want to thank the board once again for allowing me to speak today. The plan to develop the Point Stratford is a good plan. It'll be a good thing for Stratford, but I have a couple of things I'd like to have this board consider as conditions as they look at the master plan proposal. One is the remediation of contamination in that area. We should see some type of timeline and responsible entities responsible for what contamination, especially as it relates to the mud flats, which I understand the Army now is going to take that on. But I think that proposal needs to include their commitment within the timeline of the whole proposal, because I would hate to see this proposal be presented and not let the Army engineer, the Army, be able to say they're in commitment and they buy in to making a commitment to accomplish the cleanup that's required. So I'm hoping that this will be a more comprehensive plan as it relates to the removal of the contamination. And at the same time, I'd like to see a plan that defines when the demolitions will take place also, so we can see where in the stages these things are taking place, because it could present some potential health concerns in the surrounding residential areas. Finally, again, it's a good plan. I'd like to make sure we're keeping an eye on that 10% open space. And I know that the plan that was done on this area was going to also be able to provide public access to the water and the surrounding areas there. So we just want to make sure that public will continue to have access to the water front that's being affected by this development. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody else who would like to speak in favor of this application? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition to oppose this application?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Name is Walter P. Remcunis, 425 Second Avenue. I'm not really against the development, but I have a question here, having spent 45 years on that property. Mr. Paul talked about the mud flats. I want to know what, when and where are they going to take care of that hot spot smack dam down the middle of the plant where all the plating and all that type of stuff is in the ground? when are they going to start digging that out? Or what remedial service are they going to perform to take care of it? Because that was one of the big things that came back up a while ago about the contamination on the property itself, not the mudflats, but the property itself, where all that section, plating, and other sections there with all that various mercuries and all the other stuff that's in there, PCBs and all. When will it be taken care of? Who is going to do it? And who is going to watch to make sure that that doesn't go anywhere? Other than that, I think with the deletion of the heights of the buildings and stuff, you can't say anything because you have no idea what they're talking about. I've walked every place on that place. I've got 45 years, as I said. And it's a good place. I'd like to see it redeveloped. The gentleman's got in his mind, every time I hear, is a big hotel. How high? Where is it going to go? And so on. That is another thing that's questionable in my mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody else who would like to speak for or against? Mr. Gershom, would you like to respond to any of the comments?
I'd actually be interested in speaking with the gentleman who just addressed the commission. I would love to learn a little more about his experiences on the property and
I think Mr. Ren-
buried there that we don't know about.
I'm sure Mr. Rancunas would be delighted to talk to you.
I'm not an engineer. I don't play one on TV. I'm not able to answer technically how the ins and outs of the remediation that will take place on the property, other than to say it's our intention that the remediation will take place essentially parcel by parcel. As a piece is redeveloped, it will be remediated. As the next piece is redeveloped, it will be remediated. We believe that that will be the most efficient and economically viable way to get the remediation done. It, of course, will be done in strict compliance with all applicable laws. The property is subject to CERCLA. The property is subject to state environmental laws. One point about our responsibility versus the Army's responsibility. Today, the Army is liable to remediate the land and the water. They own it. They contaminated it. There's no question. We are agreeing to assume responsibility for remediating the land to save them from doing it. But should we fail to do it, their underlying liability never goes away. So if that provides any comfort to members of the community or to this commission, there's an awfully deep pocket that sits behind us on the
responsibility. So in short, the Army is not off the hook regardless.
Correct.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The public hearing is not, I am not closing the public hearing. I am, though, looking forward to have a motion made for a continuance to the next public hearing, which will be on November 29th. May I have a motion?
So moved, Madam Chair. Motion to
moved by continue. Mr. Fuller. Is there a second? Second by Mr. Giuliano. All in favor?
Aye.
Chair votes yes. Anyone opposed? Motion passes. Thank you very much. Now we'll need to move to the next application. Thank you very much. The next application, I think, Ms. Baker, it's yours. It's for the, it's a text amendment. It's actually for 225 Lordship Boulevard. I think the two of them go together.
Perhaps you will entertain a motion to consider items 7 and 8 at the same time for public hearing.
Right.
Items 7 and 8 are both for the same property. They're both applications of Kolick Properties. Perhaps you can combine them for public hearing. It's up to you.
We would like to combine them from public hearing. Do we need a motion to do so?
Motion to consider items 7 and 8, text amendment of Kolish Properties.
We have a motion to consider number 7 and number 8 together. Okay. Is it motion by Mr. Forrester, second by Mr. Giuliano?
Sure.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. Anybody oppose? Thank you. Okay. Ms. Baker, I think it's your turn, right?
Yes. Number 7, text amendment, petition of Kolish Properties, LLC, seeking to add new text to section 5.3.16, allowing for adaptive reuse of hotels in a CA district to be converted into residential apartments. And number 8, 225 Lordship Boulevard, petition of Kolish Properties, LLC, seeking a special case approval per section 5-3-16 to convert from a hotel to a 110-unit studio one-bedroom resident apartment in a CA district.
Chairman, members of the commission, I'm Raymond Rizzio. I'm happy to be before you tonight representing Kolish Properties with regard to this application for a change in your regulations. This is with regard to your adaptive reuse regulations, which is section 5.3.16. What we'd like to do, this regulation kind of changed the text, is a result of, we have a situation down on Lord 225 Lordship Boulevard, which is the old, you know, the hotel, and it was a conference center. It was built many years ago, and the hotel has turned into kind of a very difficult what we'd say development for the city. I mean, the health department's been there, the police have been there, and it's turned into more of an hourly rate, an hourly motel, and not been something that's really been good. The property's been up for sale. Our client is in the process of acquiring it and would like to convert this into residential apartments. The beauty of this, it becomes less transient in nature. You don't end up with people who are there by the hour or by the night. You're looking for yearly rentals. Our client owns about 1,000 units between Westchester and in Fairfield County, Stamford, Norwalk, Bridgeport, Rye, and they specialize in converting a lot of these projects into very well-run apartment buildings. Now, one of the problems in converting this, and why we sought the adaptive reuse, is, you know, you have your apartment equivalents for each area of the town, and those are pretty much used up. So the question became, in what do we do with this hotel? How do we stabilize it? How do we make it work? How do we turn it into a real asset versus an eyesore along Lordship Boulevard? Our clients came up with the idea of turning this into residential apartments. And in doing that, we ended up looking at your adaptive reuse regulation. And adaptive reuse is great because it kind of says, we give the board a lot of discretion in approving these projects. Kind of, it's basically see what fits, make it work, and we kind of get, it's a one chance of the board to operate outside the box and kind of draft their own rules as it applies to a specific property. Now, what we've tried to do is adapt this so that we would allow apartments to come into this regulation or into the adaptive reuse and come into this property without having to increase the amount of what's so-called residential units to the area. So, for example, we state in our request to you that we would like in a CA zone the ability, if it's a hotel, that it can be converted into residential apartments, provided the apartments do not exceed the number of dwelling units are in the hotel. So, in other words, what the commission basically keeps everything status quo with regard to the number of residents that could move into an area. So if you're worried by having these apartment equivalents so that you don't have an increase in density in any particular neighborhood, by converting the hotel to apartments under the adaptive reuse and agreeing to a restriction that there is no more increase in the amount of, in effect, residential units, whether it be apartments or units, that allows this project to be converted. So in other words, in an area where all the apartment equivalents have been met, we could not just apply for apartments in this zone because the equivalents have been exhausted. Under adaptive reuse, if it's a hotel, meaning that there are residents that are occupying these units, but they are not counted in the apartment equivalents, this adaptive portion of the adaptive reuse regulation that we're requesting would allow for the conversion without having the apartments act or exceed the equivalents. In other words, we couldn't, rather than going to a ZBA and looking for a waiver or changing, coming to you and changing the apartment equivalents, it would be in these very limited scenarios where you already have residences within a zone that would gives you the opportunity to turn these residences from a very transient, transit-operated building to a very stable commercial enterprise. And that's what we're trying to do here. So by renovating this hotel, by cleaning up the property, turning this hotel into an apartment house that will basically go from 149, I have to apologize if I'm going to go back and forth a little bit. When I'm talking about the text amendment, we'll use this property as a hypothetical because it's not supposed to be, it's traditionally this property. In a situation like 225 Gordon Chipola, there's 149 hotel rooms. We would like to convert it into 110 apartments under the adaptive reuse regulation if this commission would grant it. What that would allow us to do is combine apartments, preserve the building, yet bring a much more stable environment to the area. In doing that, I went through the planning comments, and the planner had recommended, we had asked for one-to-one, and thinking, even though we weren't applying for one-to-one, I thought for adaptive reuse, it would be important that we didn't just pick a number out of a hat. And the whole theory is that you have residents there, and that to have temporary residents for permanent residents, as long as you weren't increasing the number, that was my idea in going one for one. So in other words, when you read the text amendment, it says that you cannot exceed the number of units that are currently hotel rooms. Is that all right? We're in our special case, we're actually going to ask for 110, which is 73% of what the commission of what the amount of units or residences that are currently there. We would agree to a modification that would go down to 75%. What we'd like to do is convert so that we'd have 70 efficiencies and 41 bedrooms. Efficiencies in this instance would be about 450, or studios would be 450 square feet. The one bedrooms would be about 900 square feet. Rents for these typically will be starting between $800 and $900 per month for the efficiency slash studios, and the one bedrooms would be about $1,200 a month. We have a ton, our clients has purchased and developed a ton of efficiencies in units in Stamford, and typically in those units, the efficiencies, which are $350 to $450, the rents are like $1,300 a month, and the two bedrooms and one bedroom will go for $2,000 to $2,100 a month. There is a very, and you say, gee, 450 square feet is pretty small. It's funny, if you've read articles in the New York Times, they have now what's called, the big thing is called micro apartments. And micro apartments are pull down beds, 180 square feet, and basically enough for people to come in and sleep. Now, who's attracted to an efficiency? If you're a single person, you have enough room for your bed, you have enough room for a kitchenette, you have enough room for a dining area, and it's a very efficient way to live, it's a very inexpensive way to live, but it's comparable to what you would get. Yet you get the amenities. In this instance, we will have a fitness center in our hotel, in our in So we have, what you have is a lot of young kids, younger, when I say young kids, I mean younger workers and employees, single people who basically use an apartment for a place to stay. They tend to eat out more. They, you know, it's funny, you spend, we've represented a lot of developers building a lot of apartments, and they all spend a lot of money on kitchens in these apartments. And for the most part, they need a warming trough. Not many, you put these elaborate kitchens in with all these beautiful appliances, and you end up with a situation where everybody's eating out 6 out of 7 nights a week and warming stuff up the other night. So in suburban towns, it's the single family house mentality and the apartment mentality are very difficult, because most people are used to a lot of apartments coming out of condominium projects. And there's not a lot of true, you're starting to get now in Stratford, true apartment buildings with amenities that are being built. And they become very good taxpayers. As you know, they don't become a strain on your schools. Here with 70 studios and 41 bedrooms, you're not gonna see families leasing that. So it gives the commission that protection that you're not gonna have. This is gonna put any additional burden on your schools that you might see in 2 and 3 family units. Because as you know, they take advantage of the school system. However, it also increases your tax base by the number of units that are allowed in a building. Now, so we basically put in a regulation that says we would like to be able to convert hotels into apartments. And then we ask for certain exceptions that would not have to apply from the general regulations to when you have an adaptive reuse regulation. A lot of towns, for example, Bridgeport, Trumbull, other towns that I've actually written the adaptive reuse regulations for, the adaptive reuse regulations is a clean slate. If it's a building over a certain age, pre-existing non-conforming, basically you come with a plan, if the commission likes it, you approve it as per the plans, and that's what they get. In this instance, Stratford has pretty much a very liberal adaptive reuse, but when it comes to requirements, it also means that you have to abide by, certainly with regard to apartments, sections of in section 5 of your regulations. We had asked, and I can modify some of this, and some of this was addressed by Jay and addressed by your planner, is that we had asked for exceptions to section 5.3.2, which is that gives you the goals for apartment requirements. And I know this sounds funny, but the thing that we couldn't, there's no definition, and it talks about a bathroom, and it talks about bathroom with a water closet, yet there's no definition of a water closet. We didn't know whether that was a separate water closet within a bathroom that you're expected to have, or just a toilet within a bathroom. And I know that sounds crazy, but when you go to do a project that's going to have a multi-million dollar renovation, and you're looking at a regulation and whether it adapts, I think we wanted to be extra careful and just not have that apply. But with regard to section 5.32 and the regulations that required, we satisfy all those regulations and would agree to a modification as suggested by your planner, that section 5, the omission of section 5.3.2 can come out of the text amendment. In other words, we wanted to not have to abide by 5.3.2. It's okay to, we would be okay to remove that from our request. With regard to apartment equivalents, section 5.3.5, we have that in our text amendment to say that we would like to have 5.3.5 apply to this, to an adaptive reuse of a hotel. I think both the Planning Commission, and I think your planner have stated that that would not be a problem. 5.3.5 shouldn't apply to adaptive reuse of an apartment situation, because there'd be no reason for, if you didn't have the limitation of the apartment equivalents, it wouldn't be necessary to have this apartment conversion apply. So 5.3.5, we would like to not have apply to adaptive reuse in a apartment situation. Section 5.3.8, we ask that it would not apply. And the reason we ask that it would not apply is it requires full basements. Our hotel is in a, basically in a low-lying area. We would not be permitted to put a basement in that area, basically on flood requirements and everything else. And I think you got to remember, all of these things come before you with a special case. So you would have the right under your special case if you didn't like this, if you didn't feel there was enough storage, or you didn't feel that if a basement was required, you would have the right to deny the special case. But we didn't believe there should be the requirement of a full basement, that all these apartment buildings have full basements. We can't possibly have a full basement in this hotel and in most hotels, which are built on slab. So that's the reason we wanted 5.3.8 out. The other issue was section 5.3.9, which requires that all of your apartments have 10% of the apartment be used for storage. Not really sure where that came from. I've never seen a storage requirement for apartments. I've seen, in effect, commissions look at applications and say, you know, where are they going to store things? In our situation, and you would have the right to question storage under special case. We don't believe the requirement of a 10% storage requirement is it would be excessive. For example, if you have a 450 square foot apartment, you would have to have 45 square feet of that for storage. We have room for dressers, we have a coat closet, and those questions are more, we believe, special case oriented as an adaptive reuse. We also have an area where we'll have storage cages. So in other words, if somebody wants things stored, but they don't fit in their apartment, they can rent a storage cage down on a lower level. So to require 10% of an apartment to be storage becomes a very big impediment when you're looking for the one-bedroom and studio apartments. And then the last was passive recreation. We believe it's covered under section 5.314. We wanted to accept that out. If you look at your passive recreation, that is not currently a requirement in your regulation, but we just wanted to make it clear that it didn't apply here. The problem here is in an apartment house, a lot of times, especially in this area, our recreation is going to be on the interior. We're going to have a fitness center, and we're going to have other amenity areas where we have a picnic area that's large, but as far as having passive recreation, we're surrounded by oil tanks, a garbage, a contractor garbage slash area, and then we have a commercial area outside. We're not looking to attract families. I don't think this commission wants to see, in effect, families. These are going to be all one-bedroom and apartments. Basically, that we believe enough of the amenities will be the green space that we can provide pursuant to what we're going to propose in our special case. And along with, there's currently a pool here that will be changed to a fitness center and a laundry. So we believe that is all the amenities that would necessarily be required. Keep in mind, in this instance, where it's a little different, we also have this area out here which will be subject to future development. We don't know yet. We're waiting for what kind of retailer or user will come up front. So the reg and the text amendment, maybe what we should do is address the issues of the text amendment first before we get into the special case, because the commission's concerns on the text amendment will affect the special case with regard to compliance. So would now be a proper time for me to vet questions the commission may have with regard to, this is always the dangerous thing with doing a special case that's designed around a text amendment that you propose, so that you've got a plan that works with your text amendment, but you may not have a text amendment that a commission will approve that allows you to go forward with your special case. Correct, Counselor? That's one of the issues. So if there's major issues or there's issues or questions that we can help resolve that allow us to move forward with our special case or with confidence move forward with our special case, we should probably vet those out now. And if you think I'm out of line, I'm just...
Attorney Rizzo, one of the things you might want to take note of is that we don't have a lot of hotels that are that would apply to adaptive reuse.
Correct.
So this particular tax amendment, for the large part, will be for this particular location. So they
correct.
Do go hand in hand. Although I know your point is you should make the tax amendment broad, because there might be some other property that would fall under it. Quite honestly, I don't think there is, that I could think of, another property that really will fit under it. So they are going hand in hand, and we can start with the questions on tax amendment, but they'll probably lead into the special case regardless.
Correct, but for example, if you were to pass a tax amendment that doesn't fit the special case, I have to be able to modify my application so that I'm compliant in making my application for the special case. Does that make it, Counselor, you can, maybe you, if you can explain a little better than me. I don't know if I'm
well, I think I understand. I think I understand, but you submitted them at the same time. So unless you're asking us to delay on the special case until we settle the text amendment, you've brought them together, and one does lead to the other. I mean, unless you can think of another way of approaching it.
Correct.
And he could always withdraw the application for special case in the event that this commission adopted text amendments as proposed, but with certain amendments that the special case would not comply with.
That's an option. Okay. Let's move it along a little bit. I'd like to open this up to some questions from the commissioners. Who would like to, anybody like to start? You can, oh, gee, thanks, Mr. Fuller. Mr. Giuliano, would you like to dive in? Okay, Mr. Baker. Mr. Forrester. Okay. I have a few things, and again, you all can jump in if need be. On the text amendment, and these are just general, what is it that you consider storage? Is storage a closet? Is it drawers? Is it where you can store your car at? I know that's one of the areas that you would like to, one of the sections that you would not, you asked that it not apply in this particular case, but how do you define storage?
In my mind, it would be, because it would be impossible, it would have to be a fixed closet, a fixed room, something that would allow you to approve a plan that doesn't include transient, temporary storage. So for example, I don't think you want a plan that shows a 10 by 5 foot armoire in each unit and call it storage. I think the intent of the storage is to say that a physical either room or boundaries that are permanent in nature that allow for storage would be what I would assume that Jay, if he was looking at a plan and saying that you comply, he'd be looking for either closet or separate rooms or basement areas that cannot be picked up and moved.
But if the text amendment said that we looked for 10% storage, but that storage did not have to be within that footprint, but provided reasonably accessible to that apartment, wouldn't that meet those same needs?
If you said storage, that would have to be 10%.
If we, and I'm trying to say this in a way that makes sense, if we wanted 10% preserved for storage for each apartment, but we also allowed for that 10% to be does not have to be located within that footprint
correct.
Of the apartment, it could be a part of a basement if there was, or a cage or someplace that was easily accessible
correct.
To that renter.
You typically have that in apartments, but your regulation doesn't read that way. Your regulation says the 10% has to be within the apartment. So, for example, be within their unit, because you don't want to take away from living space in units that are relatively smaller.
Okay, but at the same time,
but I would think
people do come with clothes.
Correct.
And you want to have enough space that people can put their clothes, their shoes, their immediate needs.
Then what would be required would be added to the amendment in these adaptive reuse provisions that I'm just addressing your concern. The regulation would need to change, because right now you have to have 10% within the unit. If most apartment buildings, and I've been in a bunch of apartment buildings, unless you go and add up all your closets, most apartment buildings come with storage outside of the unit, especially, like I said, storage cages that are independent of the unit. So, because people don't want to use up their living space on something, you know, closets and clothes are one thing, but some people don't need a lot of storage. So, but the commission, in order to allow it outside the individual apartment, would have to add that to the regulation. So, in other words, if it wasn't to omit section 5.3.9. It would say, as to section 5.3.9, the 10% storage requirement may be met by overall storage within the building.
Okay, I understand that. But if we wanted to make sure that there's enough closet space, because hotels typically don't have closet space.
In your special case, if say we took out 5.3.9, now we get to your special case. And you know what? There's no requirement for you to have storage, but there's no requirement for us to pass your special case unless you show us that you can provide enough storage for your tenants. So what I'm saying, it becomes, and this is especially true in adaptive reuse, where the whole reason you have adaptive reuse is the buildings don't really match up to, you're taking an existing building and you're changing the use, and sometimes you're trying to fit a square peg into a round hole, and you can't do it because the regs weren't written for these type of buildings.
Okay.
So you, under your special case, if you take section 5.3.9 and don't make the 10% as it reads a requirement, you have the ability, when it comes to the special case, and the council, I would think you would rely on this, can say, that's nice, we like your plans, but you have a building here, we believe there needs to be more storage area within the building. Find it before we approve your special case.
Okay.
But the regulation, the way it reads, treats this like a townhouse that's built in, you know, up off the Merritt Parkway, that was built specifically for an apartment. You know what I mean? So that's, you have, what we're taking out of your regulation does not prevent you from imposing, when reviewing the special case, if because of all the discretion you have when it comes to a special case. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So you're really putting more focus on the special case as the defining document or approval as to the project, as opposed to the text amendment, which would allow the adaptive
reuse.
Right,
because remember, when it comes to adaptive reuse, it's always special case. It's special circumstances that bring it before you.
Okay.
We're not starting from scratch.
Okay, different topic. You took a one-for-one one-for-one approach to the text amendment, even though the special case would be possibly less. If in our judgment we don't want a lot of efficiencies, maybe it doesn't fit the particular population that we're trying to attract or that we believe as a community would fit, that would still leave us very little latitude to say we would prefer to see more one bedrooms, maybe a few two bedrooms, maybe even a few three bedrooms. Why would we want to put in our text amendment a one-for-one.
I will tell you why, the thinking behind why I proposed that. The thinking behind why I proposed that was that I did not want the commission to think or the commission to be exposed to a situation where it was open-ended for conversion of an apartment. That I want, the whole argument is we can convert these residents, so-called temporary residences, so you already have residential living in this building of a certain density. I wanted to say you can convert so that you're not adding any additional residencies to this.
So the language would be no more than the current.
Correct. Correct. So that it, you keep your apartment equivalents. So right now, when you have in these in your town, you have apartment equivalents in each area. You also have other alternative type housing, meaning mm-hmm. hotels, that don't count toward the apartment equivalents, but are residential occupancy. I just wanted to say you keep your apartment equivalents and you keep the same amount of residential. You cannot exceed the amount of current residential occupancy there is in that neighborhood. So it didn't expose, the regulation wouldn't expose for an increase in residential occupancy within a district. Does that make sense?
Yes, but that then assumes that a hotel room that's an efficiency would be basically the equivalent of a one bedroom, for example. It's a thought.
Your planner recommends, and it's funny, when you look at what your planner recommended and what we ended up designing, and I apologize because I literally did not get the Planning Commission's decision until this afternoon. So we're at 73%. The planner is at 66%. Planning Commission's at 66%.
Hmm.
So we're at 100 units. We're at
110.
110 units, and the Planning Commission's recommendation is 99.
Mm-hmm.
So if the commission required as a condition of our special case that we reduce the number of studios from one bedrooms, from studios, or increase the number of one bedrooms, or reduce the number of units to 99 units or 105 units, and that was resulted in an increase of more one bedrooms, that would be a condition that we would either have to accept or not accept. Your Planning Commission and our plans are not that far off. I mean, they're actually pretty close when you consider.
The Planning Commission and in your special case are not that far off.
Correct.
But the text amendment would allow for a lot more.
Correct. And the only reason for the text amendment was just to prevent an application coming before you that would increase the amount of residential units.
But we could make it less.
Correct. Oh, you have the ability to do a lot of things. Yes, clearly you control density. And the whole application process, and like I said, was theoretically not to expose the commission to an increase in density of residential units than currently exists. We, in our special case, are at basically 73%, and the Planning Commission would recommend 63%. 66%, I apologize. That would require a change in the application. I don't know if the commission would want to see that change in an application if they decided for a different percentage than our special case matches up, or that they would condition it upon final plans showing meeting this condition.
I don't, at the moment, have any more questions. Mr. Fuller?
It's more of a question. To Planning Administrator Jay Hibansky. With this text amendment, what other properties would be subject to this sort of, we don't have too many hotels, I'm thinking three or four off the top of my head.
I can only think of one that might be, and that would be the Honey Spot.
Yeah, in my research, I believe I found four total sites. There's the Stratford Hotel in Conference Center, which has 145 units, hotel rooms. the New Stratford Motor Inn, which has 18 units, the Quality Suites, which has 82 units, and the Honey Spot Motor Inn, which has 92. Those are all hotels within the CA district.
How about Marnix?
I don't believe that's CA. Okay.
That concludes my questions about the text amendment.
For Attorney Rizzo, is there like a market analysis? You're saying that your people, you know, this is like your top dogs over here. This is what you do, and you come up with that ratio of 70-40 for this here. You know, 70 efficiencies, 40 one bedrooms. I mean, well, and you're saying, you know, you started off in Stanford or whatever, and there's like you're going to do this, and we're going to have people moving right in, huh? They're going to be, you know what I'm trying to get at here? And then one last thing, and then I'll let you go. I just can't see having this. People need personal space. You can't just, they're going to be throwing stuff in their car. Their trunk's going to look like your linen drawer. I mean, I just can't go there. I mean, I just want to let you know that much of it, because personal spaces, they got to have space. I don't know what we're trying to make here. I mean,
well, the question becomes, the concern being, is it the storage space, the living space? I mean, believe it or not, the 450 square foot studios and efficiencies, believe it or not, are very popular, and they do have a tremendous amount of demand. Now, the one bedrooms are going to be 900 square feet, but there's an increase in rent and everything else that goes along with that.
Is this like a monolithic pour? Is this an open plan? Is there walls that are supporting everything? Is this all steel? I have no idea. Do you know offhand? Because you could reconstruct something to where at least they could have a space to put stuff. I mean, they're just going to be living in the stuff out of their cars. I mean,
no. I mean, you're gonna have closets. You're gonna have
okay
dressers. It's going to be, you know, single folks. If they need storage, there'll be storage that'll be available within the building.
Yeah, I just see storage on one floor there for probably the management or whatever it would be, and that's it.
Well, it would seem to me that what the commission's concern would be is that you want storage. I don't know if all the commission feels like this, but you could certainly, you could, no, what I'm saying is you could modify the text to say that 10% storage needs to be submitted within the building, but not necessarily within the unit.
No, I understand. I mean, we'll walk it over.
Ms. Baker?
Are these furnished apartments?
No. No, you're going to have, they will be, you have your own bed, and you have your...
You keep saying dresser, like they'll have
right
a dress. So you're not going to supply that.
Well, in some instances, we may. They're not. They don't have to be furnished apartments. They are. Once they're apartments, as the regulation, whether they're furnished or unfurnished.
Folks, please. Can we? I appreciate if you can quiet.
In the regulation. Let me just check one second. Have their one bedroom. They'll bring in their bed. They'll bring in their dresser, and they'll have their closet. And a table and a couple chairs.
So then, the only storage that will be in the room will be the closet and the cabinets.
Correct.
And
the only physical dedicated storage, I guess, is probably the way to put it. Will
right
be your closet and your cabinetry.
Okay. Mr.
Forrester?
My only question, I want some clarification. It says the minimum lot area shall be 20,000 square feet. That's in the proposed amendment, or that's what's in the current language? The minimum lot area?
This is in the
right, so that's, it would, in other words, it's going to apply to that,
correct,
because that's already there. You're not changing that.
No.
Okay, thank you. That was my only clarification. I want to make sure you're not changing that.
200,000 square feet.
Right.
In dealing, I guess what I'd like to do is probably, we had the review of the Planning Commission, which I think, if I can get this, hold on one second.
Yeah, this is where you listed out. They have 92 units.
Give me one second to get the Planning Commission's notes.
I have an extra copy here.
What's that?
Of the Planning Commission letter? I have one here.
We just for your information, we just received the Planning Commission review, so we haven't had a chance to digest it completely as well.
So the Planning Commission went through the proposal, and their issues were basically, hold on one second. They found that the proposed amendment was consistent with what the general development plan would be in town, and I don't think they necessarily had a problem with adaptive reuse applying to apartments. One of the things that they did want was that the they would like, what's that? Yeah, no, I understand. Give me one second. They would like recommended that the number of allowable apartments should be 2/3 of the total number of existing hotel rooms, and that the amendment should not be exempt from section 5.3.2, and which we agree with. They also suggest that the text amendment should not be exempt from the required dedicated storage space for every unit. We do have an issue of that being a requirement within the unit. However, a certain percentage per unit, the commission certainly could decide should be available within the building. And the text amendment did not be exempt, which requires a minimum of 10% open space on the site, and we have pretty much the 10%. It says, in the event the adaptive reuse of the existing building, so they recommend the following amended text. In the event the adapted reuse of the existing hotel buildings located in the CA district, the use of this building may be converted into a residence apartments, and the preceding section 5.3.5 and 5.3.8 shall not apply, provided the number of dwelling units does not exceed 2/3 of the number of hotel rooms which exist at the time of the application for adaptive reuse.
Mm-hmm. Which I would understand, which is leads me back to the point of why we would do a one-for-one.
I just put that as an upper limit. That's not what our special case was for. Our special case on our application is at 73%. If the commission agreed with the Planning Commission, we would certainly could modify our special case application and come back before you with an application that's consistent with the Planning Commission's recommendations.
Okay.
Meaning that we would reduce the number of units from 110 to 99, mm-hmm. meaning that we would show to you storage space. We would hope that the commission would pass a text amendment that says with 10% to be made per unit, a calculation of 10% per unit to be made available within the building so that we're not constraining living space any more than necessary. And then we would revise our special case application to meet with that text amendment. My gut instinct is the commission's not real comfortable with the text amendment as proposed. But if the commission agreed that they were comfortable with the text proposed by the Planning Commission, we could certainly amend our special case application and come back. We could also, because I could see by the amount of questions available and concerns, if the commission, before deciding on the text amendment, would like to see the special case amended so that they could see what the effect of a text amendment
would be
that it might be easier for the commission to accept the text amendment when they could visualize the application that they would be approving. Does that
make sense?
That kind of harkens back to me getting guidance from you so that I don't come in with a special case that doesn't work.
You talked right in the very beginning about kitchen space or warming space. That I didn't see it in the text amendment, but I may have just misunderstood how it read. How is that addressed in the text amendment, as opposed to a warming space versus a kitchenette?
In the text amendment, that we would agree to, if we withdrew the requirements of section 5.3.2 in your apartments. In other words, if section 5.32 remains,
mm-hmm.
5.32 remains, you have to have cooking range and refrigerator. You have to have a kitchenette or kitchen equipped with a sink provided in the facilities. So your 5.3.2 requires that, requires what we just talked about.
And you're agreeing, do you agree with
we
that?
We agree that should remain.
Okay.
We were because there was no definition of a water closet, we weren't sure that they meant that the water closet needed to be a separate room within the bathroom, mm-hmm. or it was, could just be a toilet by itself in the bathroom. There's no guidance there.
I don't know what a water closet is.
Well, that's what a water closet is.
It's a
toilet
room.
Plain, simple, zero. So you keep going.
We're getting lost in such mundane detail here, and it's taking an hour of the public's time and our time. This is ludicrous. There's a bigger, more fundamental question.
Yes.
What is behind this hotel?
Transfer station.
Yeah, what do you mean behind the hotel?
What is physically behind this site?
A transfer station.
Who would want to live there?
I think if the apartments are nice enough, the location is nice enough, it's the same distance, who would want to live next door to a train that goes by if you're not near the platform?
Let me answer that. I understand what Mr. Fuller's point is, but the Zoning Commission, if an applicant requests and believes that there's a viability and it fits the plan of development, that's not an area that we decide whether or not as a business plan, if it's viable or not. That's really the applicant. We may not agree with it, but that's for them to determine if there's a business opportunity.
It's completely within the purview of a special case.
All right, Chairman,
okay.
Maybe at this point, what I might suggest, and just because when these text amendments are proposed, and then we just got comments from the Planning Commission today, it seems like the commission that we're before tonight is more consistent with the text the text that the Planning Commission has recommended for approval,
mm-hmm.
that we can modify our plan, we can modify our request for the text amendment to be more consistent with the Planning Commission's request,
mm-hmm.
and come back before you next month with a plan.
I think that's a very good idea. This is a big project, folks. It's a work in progress, all right?
Thank you, Chairman.
And it's gonna take a little working out to find something that works.
Well, that's the hard thing when you put a text amendment forward and we have Jay's feedback, but we didn't Planning Commission to today, and then really because of public hearing requirements, we don't get your feedback.
Right.
So what we can do is, I think I've got some very pretty clear indications from a few of the commissioners as to some enhancements they'd like to see in both the text and in both the application, and we can do those and get those back to you if the commission would agree to continue this to next month.
At this point, what I'd like to do is, this has got a lot more work that we want to do. I'd like to get a motion of continuance to the November 29th and allow the applicant to come back with some more changes and feedback. At that point, the public will be welcome to make some comments for or against. I think I would like to reserve that until we get something a little more meat on that.
I think it's perfectly appropriate, Chairman.
Okay. May I have a motion for a continuance to November 29th?
So moved.
By Mr. Second. Forrester, second by Mr. Giuliano. All in favor?
Aye.
Chair votes yes.
Folks,
anybody oppose?
Thank
motion
you for your
passes.
Time and your input.
Thank you. Discussed in that pile. I know. I got big piles.
You
here.
Will. You promise? Barry, I need one to stamp. I need a copy to stamp. Thank you.
The World Series. No, the World Series. Is it 2-0, please?
I think you're right. All right. For the application that I think a great many of folks are here to review, Mr. Forrester.
Certainly.
I believe it's yours.
Item number 9, 1307 Stratford Avenue and 40 Johnson Court, petition of First Baptist Church of Stratford, Inc., seeking special case approval per 4-1-6-3. And 5.1.1 and 7.1.1 to construct an 8,788 square foot community center containing classrooms, credit union, thrift bookstore, and office space in an RM-1CA district.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, Madam Chairman, Madam Secretary, Ms. Baker, members of the commission, and Mr. Hibansky. My name is Barry Knott. I'm a lawyer with the firm of Knott, Knott & Dunn with offices at 1656 Main Street. I'm here this evening on behalf of the First Baptist Church of Stratford Incorporated, which is located at 1301 Stratford Avenue, Stratford. Pastor William Sutton sits behind me in the front row. He is the pastor of the church and has been the pastor for the last 19 years. By the way, the First Baptist Church of Stratford is the oldest Baptist church in Fairfield County, having been incorporated in Stratford in 1877. The church has existed continuously in Stratford since its organization in 1877, originally housed at Academy Hill in a private residence, and then moved over to this location years later. This time I'd like to submit the certificates of mailing and make reference to a folder of exhibits which I've handed to each of you, to which I'll be making reference during the course of my presentation. Exhibits 1-9 are photos of the properties that are the subject of this application and the immediate neighborhood. Photograph number 1 is a photo of the vacant building at 1307 Stratford Avenue. This building is going to be knocked down, and the lot upon which it sits is going to become part of the parking lot that's incorporated into our site plan that we'll get into in a few minutes. Exhibit 2 is another photo of the same building, and this shows that it is immediately adjacent to I-95. So as far as the Stratford Avenue neighbors are concerned, there's nobody that immediately abuts this property that's going to be affected by this application. Photograph number 3 is a photo of the house at 40 Johnson Court. This is owned by the church. It also will be raised, and this particular lot, as well as the parking lot at 1307 Stratford Avenue that I just showed you, will be the site of the new community center. Exhibit 5 is another photo of 40 Johnson Court. You can see in the background to the right of this photo, the back, a white concrete block back. That's the back of the building at 1307 Stratford Avenue, which is in photo 1 and 2. Exhibit 5 is the back of the church, which is at 1301 Stratford Avenue. And once again, if you look to the left of the church, you can see the block building, which is the strip center at 1307 Stratford Avenue, which is in photo 1. Exhibit 6 is a photo of the three buildings, really. The house on the left is 40 Johnson Court. The The white block building in the middle is the back of 1307 Stratford Avenue, and the brick building on the right is the back of the church. And this is the area where the new building is going to be located. Exhibit 7 is a photograph of a large parking lot between Johnson Court and Hamilton Avenue, which is owned by the church and which currently serves as parking for the church services that go on Sundays at 1301 Stratford Avenue. Exhibit 8 is a photograph of the back of the church taken from the parking lot that was in photo 7. You can see the steps down from the parking lot to Johnson Court. And Exhibit 9 is a photo also taken from the parking lot across Hamilton Avenue, showing the commercial buildings on the corner of Main Street and Stratford Avenue. Now, Exhibit 10 is a copy of the assessor's map for the area, and I've highlighted in pink the building at 1307 Stratford Avenue. That's the building out on Stratford Avenue. Immediately behind that, I've also highlighted in pink the building, the house at 40 Johnson Court. It's the pink area that is going to be the location of the new building that this application is for tonight. The yellow next to the pink is the church building at 1307 Stratford Avenue. And then behind that is the large parking lot that one of the photos showed you. And then you see there are three parcels going down Johnson Court, which are also owned by the church. And there's another parcel on Hamilton Avenue two other parcels on Hamilton Avenue that's owned by the church. So the pink locations are the location of this proposed community center, and the yellow locations are all of the other properties owned by the church in this immediate area. Now, this is an application for special case under sections 4.1.6.3, 5.1.1, 7.1.1, and 20.2 of the zoning regulations in order to raise the existing buildings at 1307 Stratford Avenue and 40 Johnson Court in order to construct a new 8,700 square foot two-story church community center with meeting rooms and offices. By way of explanation of all those regulation sites, 4.1.6.3 allows a church, parish hall, or other religious use in a single-family residential zone subject to special case approval. Section 5.1.1 allows any use permitted in a single-family zone to be permitted in an RM1 zone, which is where 40 Johnson Court is located. Section 7.1.1 allows any use permitted in RM1 zone to be permitted in the CA zone, which is where 1307 Stratford Avenue is located. And Section 20 is the special case regulation. So because churches are allowed in a single-family residential zone, they're also allowed in an RM1 multifamily zone, and they're also allowed in a commercial zone. And this particular property is a combination of multifamily at 40 Johnson Court property and commercial at the 1307 Stratford Avenue property. Exhibit 11 is a revised site plan eliminating three handicapped parking spaces erroneously shown on our original site plan submitted with the application. Jay discussed this in his comments, which I will get to in a little while. First, however, I'd like to introduce Mr. Pat Rose of Rose Tizo LLC, architects, surveyors, and engineers, who will take you through the site plan, architectural renderings, and comments from John Casey, our town engineer. Pat?
Good evening. My name is Patrick Rose, representing Rose Tizo & Company, Fairfield, Connecticut. I'm an architect licensed in the state of Connecticut, representing First Baptist Church of Stratford tonight. Just want to pass out to you comments or responses to comments from John Casey that we received today that we responded to as quickly as we could. And I'll give Jay two copies, one, you know, regular size. What you have in front of you, or you will have, is the rendering of the facility, in 11 by 17, which we'll all get to. And a revised SP1 site plan and a revised SP2, which respond to John Casey's comments, which I'll go through in a little bit. Right now, I'd like to just briefly go through the development